We will be looking at assembling, administrating, scoring, analyzing, and improving tests in this presentation. When assembling a test, let's first examine the answer key for the test. Group all items together of similar format. Keep items and options on the same page. Arrange test items from easy to hard. Position illustrations near descriptions. Space the items for easy reading. Check your answer key. Determine how students record answers. Provide space for the name and date. Check test directions. Proofread the test. Next, let's talk about reproducing the test. Regardless of how valid and reliable a test is, poor copies make it less so. Make sure to check over the copies or have someone else randomly check your copies. When administering a test, maintain a positive attitude by keeping the main purposes of classroom testing in mind: to evaluate achievement and provide feedback. Too often tests are used for the wrong reasons. Examples of this include to punish. The teacher thinks, because the students haven't done the reading, I'm giving a test. Indiscriminately. The teacher thinks, it's Friday, I guess I may as well give a test. Inappropriately. The teacher thinks, I need a good evaluation, so I will give a test today. When administering the test, maximize achievement motivation. You do not want to immobilize your students with fear, but you do want them to try their best. Keep general statements about the test accurate. A test is something to be taken seriously, and this should be clear to the class. If you have nervous test takers, you can always make reassuring or motivational comments to them individually. Try to equalize the advantages that test-wise students have over non-test-wise students. Remind students of general test-taking strategies. For example, you might say, cross off options you've ruled out on matching or multiple choice questions. Keep in mind that we are interested in student achievement, not how test-wise a student is. Avoid surprises. Students should have sufficient advance notice of a test or quiz. Pop quizzes have little beneficial effect on academic achievement. Clarify the rules. Inform students about time limits, restroom policy, and answer sheet instructions before distributing tests. Students often tune out the teacher once the test is handed out. Rotate the distribution. Alternate between left, right, front, and back of the class for the beginning to pass out tests. Remind students to check their copies. After handing out the test, have them check the page and item numbers to make sure they got all parts of the test. Have students put their name on the test. Monitor students. It would be nice to trust students not to cheat, but it's not realistic. Inform students ahead of time about cheating policies. Minimize distractions. Keep noise and visual distractions to a minimum. Give time warnings, such as 15, 10, or 5-minute warnings, so the students are not caught by surprise at the end of the test. Have a uniform policy on how you collect tests. This saves time and minimizes lost papers. Prepare an answer key. Have one in advance to save time while scoring. Have an estimated time for completing the test. Check the answer key. It's always good to have another colleague check for correctness and potential problems. Score blindly. Try to keep the student's name out of sight to maintain objectivity. Check machine scores. Review the answer sheets for stray marks, multiple answers, or marks that may be too light. Check your scoring before returning the scored papers, and make sure that you record the grades in the gradebook. Just as you expect to make scoring errors, you can expect to make errors in test construction. No test you make will be perfect. Item analysis is a way of identifying items that are deficient in some way, thus enabling you to construct a better test in the future. There are two types of item analysis, quantitative and qualitative. Let's say 30 students took a multiple choice exam. The asterisk indicates the correct answer. We can see automatically that choice B was not a good distractor. We can also see that over half the class answered the item correctly. The first step in quantitative item analysis is to determine P, the item's difficulty index. When P levels are less than 0.25, the item is relatively difficult, and when P levels are above 0.75, the item is too easy. It might be better stated as the easy index rather than the difficulty index. Determining the difficulty index is important, but certainly not the only thing we need to know. In addition to the difficulty index, we need to know the discrimination index. Quantitative analysis answers questions such as, were the students who answered correctly those who did well in the overall test? Did the distractors fool those who did well or poorly on the test? To begin answering these questions, we must find the discrimination index. The steps for determining discrimination index are: arrange the papers from highest to lowest score. Separate papers into upper and lower groups based on total test scores. Half of the papers should be in each stack. For each item, count the number in the upper group and the number in the lower group that chose each alternative. To determine the discrimination index, the formula calls for the number of students in the upper group of the class who answered the question correctly, less the number who got the answer correct in the lower group. This difference is then divided by the number in either the upper or lower group. In this example, the correct answer was C. There were 11 who answered correctly from the upper group and 7 from the lower group. The difference is 4 divided by 15 and equal to 0.267, so our discrimination index for this question is 0.267. Our value of 0.267 is positive and indicates that students who did well on the overall exam answered the item correctly. Had the value been negative, it would have indicated that students who did poorly on the overall exam answered the item correctly. What is a good discrimination index? Experts disagree. Some say it should be at least 0.3. Others say as long as the value is positive, it is good. Item analysis also helps us identify problem distractors. Miskeying. When an item is miskeyed, most students who did well on the test will likely select an option that is a distractor rather than the option that is keyed. Anytime most students in the upper half of the class fail to select the keyed option, consider whether your item is miskeyed. Ambiguity. This occurs when the upper group selects one of the distractors with the same frequency as the correct answer. Quantitative analysis only suggests ambiguity and does not tell us what the root of the problem is. To determine the problem with the item, we must turn to qualitative analysis. Guessing. When guessing occurs, students in the upper half of the class respond in random fashion. Each option will be chosen about equally. This occurs when the item measures content that was not covered in class. The item was so difficult, even the upper students couldn't grasp the concept, or when the item is so trivial that the students are unable to recall it.